Hello, I'm Stephen Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today's show is a special joint production of the University of the District of Columbia and Prince George's Community Television. I'm here in Largo, Maryland, where we'll be talking about social entrepreneurship and the South Africa-Washington International Program. Nhlanzeko Kanyale is a Bachelor of Commerce student at the University of Cape Town. She's a facilitator at the Kususasu Letu Youth Foundation with an interest in women's empowerment and social issues globally. Dewald Miller is a graduate student in actuarial science at Stellenbosch University. He won the Premier's Entrepreneurial Recognition Award for Best Student Initiative in the Western Cape in 2015. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you very much, Stephen.
Thank you very much for having us.
Well, thank you for coming on. Maybe if we can start with a question for both of you. What is social entrepreneurship and why is it so important?
You know, I think social entrepreneurship is something, and the definition of social entrepreneurship depends, it's a personal experience. And different people would be able to give you different definitions. And I think that's fine. So for me personally, I think it's the ability of someone to innovate in a certain environment that has certain social inefficiencies, and to use that environment and the resources around it to make the best of it and actually solve that problem.
And fair enough, do you agree with that definition?
Yeah, definitely. For me, social entrepreneurship is about identifying a social issue, maybe in your community or your surroundings, and then thinking of an innovative idea to help for that problem to be, you know, mitigated and to be fixed through entrepreneurship. So projects involving the community as well is the most effective way to actually make that change.
And why wouldn't the government do that?
I think when it comes to the government, because they are not in that community, you know, it's not as easy for them to identify particular problems. So the people who stay in that community, who live each day, each and every day, may come up with the best ideas and feel like they have a responsibility as a member of that community to implement a social entrepreneurship initiative.
But why wouldn't the local government then do it? Certainly there are local government officials who live in the local area.
You know, Stephen, I'd actually like to add to what Nhlanzeko said there. So entrepreneurship is all about a journey, and it's about living an experience and then identifying inefficiencies in that society. And local government doesn't always have the resources or the energy channeled towards finding those solutions. And they're more likely to be in an administrative role to run the daily lives of people. And I think Nhlanzeko would agree with me that once you go onto that entrepreneurial journey, it's all about being very observant of your environment. And only once you do that, it comes to simple things like being in a bus, driving to work, being very observant about what's going on around you. And once you're doing that, you really start recognizing inefficiencies in the public. And I really think it's a great place for people that's not necessarily in those positions to really start doing amazing things in the community. And I think it's a great space, especially in a country like South Africa, to do just that.
But what about the private sector then? I asked you both about the government, but what about the private sector? Certainly a company like Coca-Cola or a big company has studied things involving efficiencies and inefficiencies for years.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't they be better off sorting out those issues?
They definitely, I think, especially in South Africa, they definitely do. So, for instance, we're all part of the South African Washington International Program, which is an NGO, a non-profit organization that gets funded through different private organizations in our country. And I think the private sector in our country is playing a key role in that, especially putting the funding out there for people to actually act on their innovations. But whether it's them taking the direct action, I think that's where people might differ, whether it's supposed to be rather people on their own or the companies directly.
Well, I find this a little interesting because at Wharton we used to talk about issues of efficiency and issues of inefficiencies and whether or not the NGO sector or the nonprofit sector really were the best people to kind of address those. Some people, as you know, would argue that a church should do it. Some people would argue that a big company should do it. Some people would argue that that the local government should do it. But there's a sector by itself called the NGO sector. And so I think maybe to an American audience who's also going to be watching this, how what are they going to learn from how you might study this, or how you as a student might think about getting involved in this sector?
Okay, so when it comes to entrepreneurship, especially social entrepreneurship, because it is so multifaceted, whether you are a BA student or an engineering student or a commerce student, you can identify issues and inefficiencies in your sectors where you are working or studying. So it's not particularly something that needs to be studied, which is the benefits of social entrepreneurship. And because of the private sector and its CSI projects, so its corporate social initiatives that it has, it funds local projects, and you can approach companies like that, especially the private sector, for funding. And a great opportunity for students, especially whether in the US or in South Africa, is to enter competitions by the companies in the private sector, where they have entrepreneurship competitions that you can enter, and you can win prizes for your particular projects that you are implementing.
I think we should sometimes be careful to try and define who and who should not engage into social entrepreneurship, because I think it's something that the community as a whole must take part in. And Glanzeko said it now quite strongly, that it's all about your environment that you find yourself in. And we both, now being university students, also got involved in our own type of entrepreneurial journey by just living our lives in that, on that platform. And being privileged enough to be at university is quite amazing, because it gives you that platform to really engage in different issues that's not necessarily in the field of what you're studying. So, for instance, I study actuarial science, but in my first year I started thinking about ideas of starting a coffee company, which is far removed from my field of expertise. But because of the environment that I found myself in, that sparked the whole idea of doing this thing, that there's an inefficiency in the market.
Well, and you keep mentioning the issue of inefficiencies, and I think that that's right. We're right now in Prince George's County, Maryland, and there's a very big university very close to where we are. It's called the University of Maryland, and it's a big, important university in this region. There are many things that are inefficient about the University of Maryland, even though I like it as an institution, but there are a lot of things that are inefficient and a lot of things that are duplicated. And for instance, I know about your coffee business, and if you don't mind me putting you on the spot, my understanding is that you basically saw the inefficiencies in your university of students not being able to get good coffee, and hence then you produced some way of students getting that coffee. But let's assume that you were American and not South African, and that you were at the University of Maryland and not at Stellenbosch. I would argue that you are now bringing entrepreneurship to the campus. So what is the value that you're bringing to the campus community and beyond the campus community?
And can I specifically refer to this specific? Yeah, so it all started with installing. I walked one day to campus and saw this girl with an empty cup of coffee. And that all sparked the idea of, I couldn't understand why someone would walk with an empty cup of coffee to class. And I remember thinking about it, was a bit puzzled with it. And then after a few weeks, I realized that the coffee industry is very big in Stellenbosch. But there was no place where students can go during the night at 3 o'clock and get themselves something like cappuccino or hot chocolate at a reasonable price. So our first thing was, we started installing coffee vending machines in different residences where students lived. But then I think where it started getting a bit bigger is when we realized how students use these cups. If you look at a student, they walk around on campus, they put it in the classroom, they leave it there. It's probably the best billboard or advertising medium that you can get on a campus situation. So we started installing and we put advertising on these cups. And basically what we were doing is using the target market to spread the word, which was an incredible experiment to see what's possible in that context. And then from there, we used cross-subsidization by using the marketing income to make the prices of the coffee and cappuccino less. So we were able to sell it at prices below market prices. And we had started with a coffee vending machine business, and I think in the United States there's a lot of opportunities like that. It all evolved in a marketing company. But that was because I think as a team we were able to follow the steps and seeing what other opportunities evolved from that. And I'm pretty sure, and what I've seen the past week in America, there's a lot of similar opportunities in this space as well.
But let's take that a step further if we can. So let's assume students are paying money to get that coffee. Is the difference between an entrepreneur and a social entrepreneur where the funds are going?
I think at the end of the day, it's how society gets influenced by this product that you create. So what happened in our case, we now enabled students to buy the coffee and the hot beverages at prices below competitive prices. So now students that wouldn't be able to afford these products earlier could now afford it. And immediately there's a benefit for the student, which I would say definitely merges on social entrepreneurship. But there's still a clear profit drive in the company itself. I don't know if you'd like to add anything to that.
With social entrepreneurship, because the primary reason for Dearwell to start Kappa Campus was to infiltrate that particular inefficiency. It wasn't solely a profit-making scheme. And furthermore, just adding on not just the students' benefits from cheaper coffee on campus, but also the companies as well can now find an easier way to market their companies at a university campus. So, I mean, it's something that, you know, there's not just companies in South Africa, but also in the US where they can benefit by advertising at a university campus through coffee cups as well.
And what about campus communities? I mean, so you're both current students. What would you like administrators, professors, other students to do to support this sector a little bit more?
Sure, that's quite a tough question. But I think because they are there within that particular community, and it's all about exposure to get the word out of a particular entrepreneurship venture that you're starting. So for universities to promote that particular business, to have a buy-in as well, to see that it is worth having at the campus and not to set it aside. So I think that's a very important factor for students to get that support and also to get mentoring as well. I mean, professors are academics. They have, you know, a high level of knowledge about a variety of things. And in terms of research, in terms of expansion of that particular social entrepreneurship venture, you can get that, you know, easily at a university structure. And so it's just really realizing that there's a high level of knowledge at universities, and even if it's not funding that you can get, but you can get research on where to grow your particular venture into.
Well, fair enough. And you mentioned the issue of mentors, and I think that's an important point for students around the world. Can you say a word or two about the mentor or mentors that you've had and how they've helped you in terms of your growth?
So I can start from just my first year, fellow peers, senior peers, to get mentored with the university curriculum, academic-wise, and also in external initiatives that I'm part of and programs that I'm part of. There's a mentorship structure who's also an entrepreneur, a social entrepreneur in particular, who really makes me challenge my views a lot. And I think that's very important as a social entrepreneur to realize that it's not just this, but to analyze how viable your idea is, how practical it is, how realistic it is, and how sustainable it is. Because I think with social entrepreneurship, sustainability is very important. Also with non-government organizations and NPOs as well, for it to be able to sustain itself into the future so that more and more people can benefit from that particular initiative.
I think as entrepreneurs, it's expected of you to step out of your comfort zone. And for instance, we wouldn't be sitting here today if it wasn't for the South African Washington International Program. And that program is an amazing platform where we can get a really diverse exposure of American society and take that back to South Africa as well and apply it in the leadership structures that we have there, but also in the entrepreneurial space. And when it comes to mentoring, there's so many different channels that you can use. But the key thing I think is those people are not necessarily going to come to you. You have to go find them. And I think we've seen it in our culture and in our different industries and student campuses. Students sometimes often shy away from those opportunities because it requires you to step out of your comfort zone. It requires you to go to someone and actually market yourself and tell them who you are and then engage with those people. And we've got so many stories in South Africa, and I'm in America, I've seen so many as well, where people just went to some people with some experience in some industry and then build a relationship that really took them to the next levels.
Well, fair enough. What would you like to get from your short-term time here in Washington?
I think the first thing for me is just being very observant of the type of culture and the type of, I'm someone that's very, very excited about business, is seeing how Americans do business and how they observe different things and different problems in society. I also think different things play a different role. The political space in America is very interesting, and how that translates back to the business environment is something that's very interesting. And I think when I get onto that plane back to South Africa, my biggest thing would just to be understand this global space and to be able to see different things and the parallels between South Africa and America. And I think there's a lot to learn.
Well, for me, it's to also get a field of networks that I can go back to when I need assistance with something. But with in terms of having a network, it's a two-way stream as well. So for them to also see benefits in investing in me or giving me advice as well. And I think because it's my first time in the US, it's the first time outside South Africa, and it's only been a week, but you know, my perspective on different ideals that I had have grown a great deal, and it's very valuable for me to see the contrast between South Africa and the US in terms of business and where I see myself and where I see the potential of South Africa, you know, to go back home and realize that there is so much potential and things that can possibly happen, and not to see the US as a benchmark, but to make it more of a closer channel for me as a South African to realize that there are things that I can make use of in the US. It's not just something that is very far off or distant as an agent of change.
Well, what would be an example of something that you'd like to take from the United States then specifically?
It's more ideas, you know, taking the metro on a daily is also has opened my eyes a great deal on the transportation system and how much it's lacking, especially from where I'm coming from in KwaZulu-Natal, where it's mainly taxis that are used. So the railway system is not to the standard that people are able to make use of it. And I think it's very important for people to realize that in terms of for growth in the country, especially in the city of Durban, because it's not the largest city, to realize that it's also in the transportation system. If that can be simplified through social entrepreneurship measures, then the growth in that particular city can flourish in that sense. So, yeah.
That's a really interesting point because, I've been to Durban and I've even been to Pietermaritzburg and between, but you're right, the infrastructure in that part of South Africa is nowhere near as developed as the infrastructure in and around Washington, D.C. So it's a fair question to ask is, you know, what's a good use of resources, societal resources and individual resources to get people from point A to point B? But it gets back to my original question is, should this be a social entrepreneurial issue? Should this be a governmental issue? Should this be a private sector issue? And in the US, we will often have debates about this because the question is, who's going to pay for it? Mm. The metro that you took this morning to get here, it cost millions and millions of dollars to build and maintain that metro. So who pays for that?
Yeah, that's a great question. So yesterday with one of the host families, we were talking about the metro, and that's Virginia and DC as well as Maryland. They have debates and arguments as to who's going to fund it, and hence the reason why, you know, such maintenance is happening right now on the metro. So with social entrepreneurship, I think something as large as a transportation system of a city, it's very important to get buy-in from the government and for them to be able to work with you and not for there to be any conflict being created. So if it's the governments that you're getting funding from and for them to have buy-in, as well as the private sector, for there to be able to work with one another in order for that goal to come into being, for them to realize that it's not just a governmental issue, it's society's, you know, it's to benefit the whole of society, all of the residents of that particular city, is very critical. So yeah, I don't think social entrepreneurship works on its own. It's very multifaceted. It's the government, it's the private sector, all working together as one to reach that goal at the end of the day.
I also think the welfare of any company is defined by the society that surrounds it. And something like an efficient transportation system would immediately benefit that specific company and the specific business in the area, which is the private sector. So I think all parties involved can see the benefits of this. And I totally agree, it's not just something that comes from one side. It's a joint effort to really achieve those different the different milestones when it comes to transportations. I think also in the South African context, it's something that will take a bit more time. We're coming from a background with a lot of social problems and social issues in our country, that it's not just that easy to get the infrastructure in place to do those type of things. But we're definitely moving there and expanding in that field.
What's interesting that we're talking about this, because the last time I was in South Africa, I took at the University of Cape Town the Jammy Shuttle, if I'm saying it right, and it was a shuttle bus that shuttled students around, similar to what many university campuses have, shuttle buses that shuttle students around. So depending on who you are, you could argue that the universities have to set up these transportation systems because the cities they're in aren't doing a good job, or you could make the case that the universities want to do it themselves. But in any case, somebody's got to pay for the drivers, for the gasoline, for the infrastructure, and for the buses themselves. I mean, this is a lot of money and a lot of effort, and somebody's got to make sure that that's on a schedule. So what's the role of a social entrepreneur to make sure that they're as efficient as they can possibly be?
I think when it comes to Jammies, my colleague next to me would definitely be the best person to answer that. She's a student at the University of Cape Town.
Yeah. So when it comes to the place of a social entrepreneur in a Jammy shuttle system, because it's already there, it doesn't mean that it can't improve, it can't get better. So where a social entrepreneur comes in is to identify that, okay, here's a Jammy shuttle, there is a schedule, but it doesn't come on time, or there may not be enough Jammy shuttles, there's still long lines, especially during peak hours. Students are standing in long lines, they're coming late into class. So what, as a social entrepreneur, can be identified? What are those inefficiencies? And then the important part is actually to come up with initiatives to assist with those inefficiencies. So a social entrepreneur is not just coming up with something, it's not just being innovative in, you know, creating something, but also, like Diervolt usually says, is identifying those problems. And with the South Africa Washington International Program, and with the sessions that we have, it makes you really critically think about, you know, problems that are happening not just in South Africa, but being exposed here in Washington, D.C., also inefficiencies that are here in D.C. as well. So it really just expands your mind and grows it into realizing that, you know, in any particular thing that you're in, you can make it better. And that is really what a social entrepreneur is about. It's not just an NGO structure, it's also individual input.
Stephen, I also think that something to be innovative, it can still be profit driven. That does not mean certain services has to be for free necessarily. I find that services that's profit driven, and they normally those services that's most efficient in society. And I think something like transportation is a good example of that. And I think there's a lot of space for that in South Africa to have a profitable business in the transportation system that can actually benefit a lot of people.
But how do you do that in a way that politically works? So if you take a university shuttle example, could you charge students more for riding on the comfortable seats?
Sure. Do we have comfortable seats?
Well, when it comes to Jammy shuttles, actually, all all transportation buses at universities, they're all the same. So when it comes to that, it's also just with social entrepreneurship is realizing or thinking about how will that benefit society as a whole, you know, making better seats. So I think that's where the question really lies. But also when it's something that's profit driven, it's also a question, where does the profit go to? Does it go to the stakeholders or is it for expansion? So when social entrepreneurship businesses or initiatives do begin, usually that profit is really for making that particular project a better one and to grow it and to make it more impactful so that more individuals benefit from that initiative. So it's not for personal benefits, but it's for the benefits of the society as a whole.
We only have another minute or two left. Is there anything else that either of you would like to say to an American audience before we get to say goodbye today?
I think coming, first of all, thank you for hosting us in your country, but I think coming from South Africa and seeing the amount of opportunities in that country and being exposed to an amazing country like America as well, I think especially as a young generation, it's up to us to drive that change in the entrepreneurial field, and we've seen so many people done so many amazing things in the different industries and the student hub. And I really think to American students and South African students, it's a lot of people has a lot of abilities that they sometimes underestimate. And it's just about taking that first step.
Yeah, most certainly. So thank you very much for having us on Higher Education. So it's all about identifying problems on campus as a student and to remove that attachment that you have to study for it or it's something that you need to follow it through. If you just realize that you can fix something and improve it, keep it simple, keep it practical, talk about it, share it with other people, get their buy-in and make that change in your campus and in your communities as well.
Well, fair enough. Thank you both.
Thank you, sir.
If you would like additional information about our guest today, please visit uct.ac.za or sun.ac.za, or sawip.org, that's sawip.org. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at highereducationtoday@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Stephen Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.